5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Liftoff.
This year alone, SpaceX will make more rocket engines than the rest of U.S. production combined. That's a lot of rocket engines.
SpaceX has been really exciting. It has revolutionized the public's interest in space exploration and rockets and sending humans back into space.
Much like the Tesla automobile, they do it their own way. And they take risks.
Yeah, well, it is science fiction. I love science fiction. But science fiction does sometimes come true.
SpaceX has become a household name in America, and it's little wonder why.
Becoming a space-faring civilization is one of those things that makes you excited about the future.
Founded by the eccentric and controversial Elon Musk, the rocket builder is now one of the most valuable private companies in the world, ranking among the likes of Uber and Airbnb. It's completed more than 67 rocket launches to date, launching north of 16 cargo missions to the International Space Station for NASA. It successfully launched Falcon Heavy in 2018, the most powerful rocket in the world. It's closing in on being the first to launch American astronauts from the U.S. since the end of the space shuttle program, and it's deep into developing and testing a new generation of engines and rockets to send people around the world in minutes and even to Mars.
I mean, I was, I think, the second person Elon pitched SpaceX to, and I was like, oh, you're going to be doing this thing that comes off, you know, national government subsidies and so forth. Oh, this is a disaster. And he was right. I was wrong. That's how that plays out.
But how did SpaceX become what it is today? Let's go back to 2001. Elon Musk had a dream, sending an experiment to the red planet. He essentially wanted to land a greenhouse with plants on the Martian surface. But after Musk put a small team together to create plans for the mission, he discovered US rockets were very expensive. Russian rockets were much cheaper, but when Musk went to buy one of their rockets, he was turned away, and reportedly very rudely.
You could tell the chief designer, he was getting agitated, you know? Finally, he was just so agitated, he literally spit on Elon. He spit on his shoes. And Elon turns to me and goes, I think he spit on me. And I said, yeah, Elon, that's a sign of disrespect.
Spurned by the lack of rocket options, Musk crunched the numbers and decided to build his own. He took money that he made from the sale of PayPal. That rocket became Falcon 1. Truly incorporated as Space Exploration Technologies, Musk's team began building its first rocket.
So this is when SpaceX really started to elbow their way into DC. They were starting to compete with the massive aerospace and defense contractors who held the keys to the most valuable launches for the US military and NASA.
He builds a rocket, and then he takes that rocket and puts it on the back of a trailer and drives it through the National Mall up to DC in a big FAA party to basically say, you know, put a stake in the ground and say, I'm here. We can do this, and we can do it a lot more cost-effective than the existing players.
I remember going to some of this industry space shows back 10 years, 12 years, and SpaceX was starting to show their face. They would have booths in a corner somewhere. They're very small. I remember asking around some of the other bigger companies what they thought of SpaceX, and they thought that SpaceX, with their proposed launch prices, very low launch prices, were really mostly talk more than anything else, and that they could never really produce a rocket that would be competitive with such low prices. I wasn't so quick to believe that, because I thought, you know, there was something unique about Mr. Musk. He did talk big. He was a little brash, but what our industry needed was somebody like, say, a Steve Jobs, somebody that could really push the envelope.
2004 was certainly a key moment for them.
SpaceX protested NASA awarding a $230 million contract to now-defunct Kistler Aerospace. SpaceX argued that NASA did not allow other companies to bid for the contract, and the government sided with SpaceX.
I think that really opened up the door for what came next.
It's a difficult road to orbit. Musk has said that the company was running out of cash in 2008. SpaceX had attempted to launch Falcon 1 to orbit three times, but had failed three times.
Musk kept pushing. Even after the third failure, I thought maybe he would wait for a year to investigate really carefully what happened and just to be more cautious. But to my surprise, within a few months, he was trying again.
Beyond putting his own money into SpaceX, Musk had to also convince some fellow entrepreneurs to invest in the company.
The funds that came in at that time, they're no dummies, right? So they had done their diligence, they understand what was happening. They saw three failures and they saw an entrepreneur who had learned a lot from that, right? And they had a lot of confidence in his ability to get to orbit. The idea there is that you put your money in before you get to orbit, lower price, and benefit from what happened next, and they certainly did.
Then, on a remote island in the Pacific Ocean, Falcon 1 did it. In September 2008, SpaceX became the first to privately develop and successfully launch a liquid-fueled rocket to orbit.
I just read every book I possibly could on rocket engineering and decided to try giving it a go. I'd actually only had enough money for three flights, so I had no more money left. And we managed to the team sort of rallied, and we managed to put together enough spare parts to do a fourth launch, and that fourth launch was successful.
So what would have happened if it wasn't successful?
SpaceX would have died.
In 2008, they made it to orbit. In 2009, they made it to orbit with their Falcon 1 carrying commercial payloads and paying customers.
That's when investors really started to pay attention to SpaceX, and their valuation took off.
Then, SpaceX got its first big NASA win, a $1.6 billion contract to launch cargo to the International Space Station. SpaceX was building its first Dragon capsule for the cargo missions, as well as developing a rocket with 9 engines instead of just one. Called Falcon 9, the rocket would be capable of sending satellites the size of school buses to orbit.
What we're looking at over there, that's a quarter section of the Falcon 9 17-foot diameter fairing. It's 17-foot diameter obviously, and 50 feet long. It's capable of taking the largest satellites in the world.
And this is when SpaceX evolved from an engineering dream into a business.
3, 2, 1.
Stage 1.
Lift off. Lift off of the Falcon 9.
First stage engine shut down.
Second stage has separated.
Lift off of the Falcon 9. Falcon 9 cleared the tower.
Over the course of dozens of launches, SpaceX continued to evolve the Falcon 9 rocket.
SpaceX has become a major provider of launch services to the U.S. military, a segment of the market which was traditionally closed to all but two companies, Boeing and Lockheed, as part of the joint venture called ULA. The company was able to break that monopoly. That's not a small achievement. That's huge.
SpaceX has led a boom in private companies that now challenge legacy contractors like Boeing, Lockheed Martin, and Northrop Grumman in the rocket business. But other young companies, like Jeff Bezos' company Blue Origin, are beginning to aim for SpaceX market share. For example, Blue Origin landed a rocket booster first.
Welcome back, New Shepard.
But SpaceX took it to the next level. While Falcon 9 has had multiple improvements, one stood out dramatically: Musk's vision of reusing rockets.
SpaceX's launching and landing of rockets is not something that they invented, but something that they've perfected and something that they were able to bring to market.
SpaceX began working on vertically landing a rocket with a program called Grasshopper. The prototype had several explosive failures. Or, as SpaceX called them, a rapid, unscheduled disassembly.
I admire them for not being afraid to fail. Engineers learn more from their failures than they do from incremental improvements.
In December 2015, SpaceX did it. SpaceX landed the booster stage of its Falcon 9 rocket on the company's landing pad in Florida.
Reusable rockets is a huge move forward, makes rockets a lot cheaper. That's really revolutionized the satellite industry.
and they landed more funding too.
Google come in with $1 billion, and then now everyone wants in, right? We're seeing retail investors come in, mutual funds, that type of thing. So you can see really the evolution of the type of investors and the milestones that SpaceX was able to hit that convinced them that this was a good investment.
Is SpaceX profitable? We are profitable.
Amid all of this, SpaceX also developed the Falcon Heavy rocket, essentially three Falcon 9 rockets strapped together and beefed up. Musk first announced Falcon Heavy in 2011.
Well, we're super excited, obviously, at SpaceX to announce that some of the details around the Falcon Heavy rocket, which is our launch rocket development, really large rocket development.
After more than $500 million in development, SpaceX launched Falcon Heavy for the first time in a near flawless launch in February 2018. Musk put one of his own Tesla Roadsters on the top of the rocket, and millions watched SpaceX send a car into orbit around the sun. Experts in the field not only admire the flashiness and the results, but also the approach SpaceX takes to solving problems.
I remember seeing some of the very large composite fuel tanks that they had built and being a bit awestruck and wondering, how in the heck did they do that? They're bold, sort of user of new materials and methods. They approach everything with fresh ideas, and they go at it very quickly and with agility.
At the same time, SpaceX was deep into work on its next milestone NASA project. After the space shuttle program ended in 2011, NASA turned to the private sector to find a solution. Without the capabilities to launch human beings, the U.S. has been paying Russia $80 million per astronaut to reach the space station.
There's this really fantastic public-private partnership between SpaceX and NASA. So NASA provided some funding to SpaceX early on to help them develop a lot of their technology, but now NASA is getting a return on that investment by hiring SpaceX.
SpaceX won a $2.6 billion contract for commercial crew.
The Dragon capsule is large and looks pretty comfortable, right? Astronauts have gone for long periods of time in much smaller spaceships. So they could also go to the moon, around the moon. They could go to the space station, and they could take individuals to the space station.
The commercial crew program, after a number of delays, is now set to see SpaceX launch its first astronauts in 2019. The capsule represents the company's first attempt at launching human beings. If SpaceX is going to fulfill Musk's dream of making humanity a multiplanetary species, the company must be able to reliably and safely launch astronauts. They completed their first successful launch, with dummies sitting in for a crew, in early 2019.
Here in Southern California, sometimes we occasionally see the SpaceX rockets in the night sky. It's really exciting. I think it's having a really big impact.
SpaceX today has more than 6,000 employees. It represents a majority of all American launches. But as space travel becomes more mainstream, so do the questions facing the company.
There are a lot more women astronauts. There are a lot more astronauts of color. A lot more people of color are astronauts. NASA's been paying attention to this for a while, and it just, again, from the outside, it feels like SpaceX hasn't been prioritizing this, because if they had, we would just see different demographics at their company. SpaceX hasn't published their diversity numbers. There was a unofficial report from 2016 that estimated that 14% of SpaceX employees are women. That's a very low number. That's a low number even for science and engineering. That's lower than the fraction of undergraduate who are women who are getting degrees in math and engineering and physics and relevant fields.
SpaceX declined to comment on diversity, but in 2018, we spoke to President Gwynne Shotwell about women in the industry.
I speak to groups of women, both teeny women, tiny girls, through college and professionals whenever I have the opportunity to do so. I became an engineer and followed this career path because of a role model. So I think it's important to be as public as I can afford to be and hopefully inspire women to kind of join me in this incredible field.
Of course, it's great that there's a woman essentially running SpaceX, but that doesn't mean by itself that the climate is inclusive for everybody. There's lots of data and studies that show that the more diverse your workforce, the better your outcomes.
And after Musk appeared to smoke pot during an interview, the U.S. Air Force reviewed his security clearance. What's next for Musk's space company? SpaceX is facing its most important test in commercial crew. And Musk is aiming to have SpaceX launch the same Falcon 9 rocket twice within 24 hours, as the company aims to make spaceflight more akin to air travel.
I'd like to introduce the first paying customer of BFR, Yusaku Miyazawa. Please come forward.
Thank you, Hiro. Thank you, everyone.
In August 2018, SpaceX signed Japanese billionaire Yusaku Maezawa as the first passenger for Starship, with a planned tourism flight around the moon. That flight is planned for 2023. Several years down the road will be the launches of Starship, the enormous rocket SpaceX is building to send as many as 100 humans to the moon, Mars, and more.
In general, Mars is far better suited to ultimately scale up to be a self-sustaining civilization.
It's one thing to send humans to Mars. It's another thing to colonize Mars. And there's a perspective by which maybe before we go to colonize other planets, we should figure out how to live on this planet without destroying it, which we haven't figured out yet.
He's easy to criticize, certainly. And he, I think, you could say he overpromises and underdelivers. But there's no question that he inspires. And I think that might be part of what works for his companies is that, he makes very bold and aggressive projections, lays out a target, and then tries to meet it. He often falls short, but, you know, raise your hand if you don't occasionally fall short yourself.
Yeah, I would categorize them as the leader at this point. This is a company that in a very short time, I would say in about 10 years, has come the farthest I've ever seen any company in this industry come.
So when is Elon Musk going to space? I asked him.
When do you think that's going to happen?
You mean like me personally? As far as me going, I'm not sure. He did suggest like maybe that I would join on this trip. I don't know.
Yeah.
All right. Please, maybe we'll both be on it.